hundreds of them, in fact, who are watching this particular program. It is important for us to remember this date because of simple reason that India has a huge casualty figures in terms of numbers. And obviously, these casualty figures have to be reduced. The Honorable Minister had committed in Brasilia and in Sweden that we will do the necessary work. And I think उनके हाथ में जो आज औजार है वो मोटर व्हीकल अमेंडमेंट एक्ट है, जो जिसके प्रावधान बहुत ही कड़े हैं और जिसको लागू करने के बाद मेरे ख्याल से जो ये नंबर्स है बोथ डेथ्स एंड कैजुअलिटीज ये कम होंगे। मिनिस्टर साहब का भी यही कहना है, कई प्रेस स्टेटमेंट्स मैंने उनको देखे हैं, बहुत भरोसा है उनको इस बिल के ऊपर। रिगार्डिंग द रोड सेफ्टी network and consumer voice, we are basically working on this subject of road safety for last many years, and we know that the passage of the road safety, I mean the motor vehicle amendment bill, has taken quite a long time, and all of us here know exactly how the deliberations went and how the bill was passed, and with full house consent. And this is the important factor. Sari पूरी देश जो है इस पे नजर रखी हुई थी कि ये बिल पास होगा, ये एक्ट बनेगा और ये लागू होगा और उसके बाद हमारे जो कैजुअलिटी फिगर्स है ये कम होंगे। नेटवर्क जो है और कंज्यूमर वॉइस जो है इस विषय पे काफी सालों से काम कर रहा है, मिनिस्ट्री के साथ भी काम कर रहा है और स्टेट्स के साथ भी काम कर रहा है। मुझे बहुत खुशी है कि अलॉन्ग विद द ऑनरेबल मिनिस्टर वी हैव विद अस ऑनरेबल मेंबर्स ऑफ पार्लियामेंट्स from both houses of parliament. We also have honorable road transport ministers from various states. We have ex MPs. We also have eminent international figures who are going to speak on the global best practices and their focus in India. So it is actually a packed house, and I would move on to my colleague Ranjit to make a small presentation about the next and tell us exactly what we have been doing over the past couple of years. Over to you, Ranjit.
Thank you, Ashim. So my job today is just to quickly introduce the Road Safety Network to our eminent panelists. Welcome to the Road Safety webinar being organized by Consumer Voice. It is being organized on behalf of the Road Safety Network. Aur niche aap bahut sare un members ke logo dekh sakte hain. I hope you can see this screen. Just wanted to check once before I go ahead.
The screen is not visible.
Is it visible now?
Yes, please. Yes.
Okay. So quick introduction to who we are as the network. This workshop is being organized by Consumer Voice on behalf of the Road Safety Network. बहुत सारे members के logo आपको नीचे दिखेंगे, ये सारे member है Road Safety Network के. Road Safety Network is a coalition of civil society organizations, academics and practitioners in the field of road safety, working all towards trying to reduce the road safety trauma in the country, which is both the fatalities as well as the injuries. And we do this through advocating various policies, laws and best practices, and we work at both the national state or we work at the national state and the regional levels, and engage with both the media and the public. One of the distinguishing features of the Road Safety Network is many of our members have quite a bit of technical knowledge in road safety. Many of us have attended courses, technical workshops, some of them offered by the Bloomberg Network, and that has really helped us to gain a deeper understanding of road safety. Many of our organizations are working on many issues with the government at both city, state, and national level. So we have a long experience in this kind of work. And between the network partners, I think we've covered the entire breadth and width of the country. Almost in every state, we have a presence. And we also have the ability to tap into the global technical expertise. So we have a lot of experts at the global level who are willing to and are able to help the network. Some of the activities that we have conducted, one of the major activities, as Ashim mentioned, was the passage of the Motor Vehicle Amendment Bill. At that time, we did a lot of media engagement. The network partners reached out to parliamentarians. In fact, I think we must have reached out to almost every single member of the Rajya Sabha at that time, answering questions, addressing concerns, and reiterating the need for this act to be passed in order to help reduce the road safety problem in the country. Many of our members were also invited to depose before the parliamentary committees, where we gave a lot of technical inputs. And we also use that time to generally at the national level raise awareness about the importance of this issue and also help to raise the voice of the victims who are often forgotten in all of this. Some of the other activities include continuing to give inputs to rules and regulations. Many of the states are putting together policies to which many of our members are giving inputs. We continue to engage with the state governments for the adoption and enforcement of this important act and other provisions in the law also. Many of our members are doing capacity building with various key state agencies such as the RTOs, the police, the PWDs, conducting technical workshops with them. And similarly, we are also trying to enhance the knowledge and understanding about road safety amongst other civil society organizations and also with the media, who play an important role. A lot of media and journalist workshops have also been conducted by the network. Obviously, as road safety activists, we do have certain concerns, and we very humbly we would like to bring this to the notice of the concerned authorities. After the euphoria and the optimism of the act passing last year, there was a lot of enthusiasm. However, the pace of reforms after the Motor Vehicle Amendment Act has perhaps not been quite as to the expectation as some of us would have expected. Many of the sections of the act are still not brought into force. Many of the key central motor vehicle rules and the regulations relating to especially helmets, child safety, the National Road Safety Board, standards for design, maintenance, and construction of roads, and electronic enforcement, which are all important amendments in the act, are still in their draft stages or still being developed. And we feel that that's an area where, if that is done, the full power of the act can really be brought to bear upon the road safety agenda in the country. As the 2019 ADZI report points out, in 2019, there was a slight increase in the number of road fatalities, so obviously a long ways to go. One of our concerns has been regarding the somewhat reluctance of the states to enforce the provisions of the Motor Vehicle Act. Of course, lately, a lot of the states have notified the important compounding notification, but there are also many other provisions in the Act which I think need a lot more enthusiastic adoption by the state governments. There is a certain feeling amongst us that there is a lack of technical expertise embedded within some of the key institutions that are dealing with road safety. There are not as many technical experts in the police and the RTOs and the PWDs and the other departments. And so sometimes the decisions regarding road safety are based a little bit on personal experience rather than a more road safety, which we see being adopted in many other countries around the world, which have really brought down the road safety, which have really improved road safety in their countries. We also feel that while the Motor Vehicle Amendment Act was an important amendment, a very significant amendment, there are still some parts of the legal framework which need to be strengthened. There are some inconsistencies, some gaps, and we believe that fixing them will really help to enforce the law in a much better way at the grassroots level and also avoid any unnecessarily legal complication later on. And we'd be happy to share some of that information with the ministry. And finally, of course, we feel that road safety needs to remain a priority. Last year, it was high on the agenda of the media and the nation. Of course, now we are in the grips of a terrible pandemic. The latest numbers show about 71,000 people have succumbed to this disease. But for road people who are in the road safety, we still believe, we still understand that this is about half the number of people who die every year in road crashes. And so the kind of attention, the kind of resources, the kind of coordination that we've seen between the center and the states, we would like to see that also applied to road safety, to recognize that it is an equally important public health issue. And it is treated with the same amount of priority. And finally, the Road Safety Network, I think, wants to position itself as an ally of the government, to work with the government to help reduce the road safety trauma in the country. We would like to have an opportunity to engage more meaningfully with the bureaucracy in order to help develop robust regulations, and we can bring to bear upon this the best practices that have been adopted in other countries, adopted for the Indian context. The minister has been very forthright about promoting the safe systems approach, also called Vision Zero, etc., which is a more data-driven and evidence-based approach to road safety. I think that idea still needs to be spread, and that's a key role that we feel that we as a network need to play. And finally, like I said, just keeping the road safety agenda high on the list of all stakeholders. This is not just the government, but also the industry, the media, and the public at large, and obviously civil society organizations such as ourselves. Thank you very much. Back to you, Ashim.
Thank you, Ranjit, for the brief about the network work. And I think the message that I get out of this is basically that the road safety agenda has to be high at all given time, because people are they are dying, they're getting injured on roads on an everyday basis. So we must actually keep up our pressure on every section of the society to remember this way. And today we specifically wanted to actually celebrate this day with the mission that the nation remembers this important act, for which the Honorable Minister and the officials of MoRTH have worked day and night and made it possible, made it happen. So we want the nation to remember that this is an important landmark judgment for saving lives. I straight away jump into the next presentation, in fact, and that is by Bloomberg Philanthropies, New York. Dr. Kelly Hennings basically is leading the Bloomberg Philanthropy Public Health Program since its inception in 2007. And she's a medical doctor and trained for public health and infectious diseases. She's leading this road safety program at Bloomberg. And Bloomberg Philanthropies initiative in New York is basically working for global road safety and works with world-leading safety road safety organizations to implement road safety activities and coordinate with in-country government and non-governmental stakeholders. Presentation from her, looking at the timeline in New York right now, 2:20 a.m. So she preferred to give a presentation. Can we have the presentation for Dr. Kelly Henning, please?
Hello, my name is Dr. Kelly Henning, and I lead the public health team at Bloomberg Philanthropies in New York City. I'd like to give thanks to Consumer Voice and the Road Safety Network as hosts of this event. I'd also like to give thanks and gratitude to be speaking alongside the Honorable Union Minister, Mr. Nitin Gadkari, Honorable Members of Parliament, and the Honorable Transport Ministers of the states. Road traffic crashes continue to be the eighth leading cause of death in the world, and the leading killer of people aged 5 to 29. Over the last decade, the Bloomberg Philanthropies program in road safety has grown, and we now cover 30 cities and 15 countries with support to strengthen road safety. The Bloomberg Initiative approaches global road safety through strong partnerships, through strengthening of data and innovation, and through local action. We focus very much on behavior change, on sustainable urban transportation, on infrastructure, and on vehicle standards. We know that our interventions are working. We have an estimated 312,000 lives saved since we began in 2007, and 11.5 million injuries prevented to date. We're really honored to be here to celebrate the one-year anniversary of the Motor Vehicle Amendment Act in India of 2019. We'd like to hail and applaud the leadership of the Union Transport Minister in passing this Motor Vehicle Amendment Act of 2019. We know that it significantly improves upon the Motor Vehicle Act of 1988 and will save lives. We'd also like to congratulate the members of Parliament who've continuously supported this work, as well as the transportation ministers of the state who have lended support and who are now implementing the Motor Vehicle Amendment Act of 2019. This is a monumental step for India and really speaks to the leadership of India in the road safety space. Other countries around the world will learn much from your example. This year, Bloomberg Philanthropies has committed to double down on our road safety investment. We're committing $240 million from 2020 to 2026. And our goal is to save 600,000 more lives and prevent up to 22 million more injuries related to road crashes. Bloomberg Philanthropies will also continue to support India in its goals of preventing road crashes and saving lives, and in providing the Indian people with safer roads. Thank you very much for having me, and I wish you much success in this day's event.
Thank you, Dr. Hennings, for your brief message about the global watch on India in terms of what we achieved after the passage of Motor Vehicle Amendment Act 2019. We now have with us Dr. Judy Fleiter. She's the GRSP, that is Global Road Safety Partnership Global Manager. She manages a team of committed road safety professionals who contribute to several aspects of Bloomberg Philanthropies Initiative for Global Road Safety. She has an experience of over 20 years managing and studying the working in various countries, in fact, in terms of road safety, reduction of road safety casualties. Global Road Safety Partnership is hosted by International Federation of Red Cross and Red Crescent Societies. And for 21 years, GRSP has focused on bringing stakeholders from all sections of the societies together to provide partnership to improve road safety in various countries, including India. And GRSP is currently active in more than 40 countries. And over to you, Judy, for your presentation.
Good morning. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Ashim, can you see my screen yet?
Not yet.
Okay, let me know if it comes through, please. Can you see it now?
Not yet, Judy.
Okay. Then I'll start with my introduction. Thank you, Mr. Chair, for your words of welcome and for the opportunity to be with you today. I would like to acknowledge and thank Consumer Voice and the Road Safety Network for hosting this important event. Ashim, can you see my screen yet?
No.
All right, thank you. I'll try again. Bear with me, please.
Yeah. Full screen, please. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. I would like to acknowledge Sri Nitin Gadkari, the Honourable Union Minister for Road Transport and Highways, also acknowledging the Honourable Members of Parliament and the Honourable Transport Ministers for the States, other distinguished guests, road safety colleagues, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to be joining you today to acknowledge and congratulate the Government of India in the 1 year anniversary of the passing of the Motor Vehicle Amendment Act 2019. I would also like to take the opportunity to recognise the Honourable Minister, sir, for your commitment as far back as the Brasilia conference in expressing the commitment of the Indian government to work to improve road safety for your communities in India. I would also like to acknowledge and congratulate the states that have already acted to implement this significant piece of legislation, and we're hopeful that many other states will act and follow your lead. As you heard, the Global Road Safety Partnership is hosted by the world's largest humanitarian organisation, the International Federation for the Red Cross and Red Crescent Societies, and we're honoured to be one of the implementing partners of the Bloomberg Philanthropies Initiative for Global Road Safety that you just heard Dr. Henning talk about. And I'm sure there are many other partners joining this important event today online. I send my greetings to all of you. GRSP recognises that every death, every man, woman and child's life who's lost on the road today is a humanitarian disaster. And so it's with that in mind that we approach our work. Let's take a moment to think about the year 2020 that we're in. Yes, we are celebrating 1 year of the passage of the MVAA. This is a critical moment in time. We are at the end of the decade of action for road safety. And we did not meet the goals that were set to reduce the harm that's caused on the world's roads during that decade. It's important to recognise that road safety is acknowledged and recognised in the Sustainable Development Goals. For the very first time, there are two clear targets set for road safety. And while the first decade of action didn't bring us the results we wanted, I'm really happy to be able to share with you, if you haven't already heard, that the United Nations General Assembly has just proclaimed, just over a week ago, a second decade of action. As I mentioned, this is a critical moment. The global pandemic has forced all of us to examine what's most precious in life. The health of our people has come into sharp focus, as has the economic impact of living differently. 2020 is not turning out to be what we thought it was. Was the first decade of action a failure? Was it worth it? My personal opinion and my professional opinion is that it was not a failure, and yes, it is worth it. So it's with increased enthusiasm that we now enter this second decade of action. And please note that there is a goal of reducing road traffic deaths and injuries by at least 50% in this next decade. India, a message from the rest of the world to you. Congratulations on what you've achieved, but the eyes of the world are on you for this next decade. You have, you can, and you must be a global leader, please, if we are to reach this new goal. You know that the highest proportion of road trauma occurs in low and middle income countries. We are looking to support India to lead in this next decade. And working together has never been more important. It's critical that we focus on what works. It's critical that we focus on the key behavioural and other risk factors, bringing evidence for the solutions to those. And finally, we have to face this together. I reiterate that India can and must be a global leader if we're to reach this goal. The Global Road Safety Partnership stands ready to assist. We have a long track record in working closely with government and non-government sectors and the private sector also and academia in India. We run capacity building training, particularly we've been working with the policing agencies in India for quite some time and continue to do so. And we're one of the partners that provides road safety leadership and technical training. And we offer a multi-sectoral approach. So in closing, I wish you well. I congratulate you again, Honourable Ministers, on this important 1 year anniversary. And I urge us all to work together to continue to save lives on the road. Thank you very much for the opportunity to be with you today.
Thank you, Judy. Before I move on to Honourable Minister Gadkariji, in fact, I would like to once again thank all the members of Parliament, the ex-members of Parliament. I would also thank all the state transport ministers who have gathered here to discuss this important event, in fact. And I now move on to Honorable Minister Gadkariji, in fact, and I will request him to basically present his viewpoint, just a starting point for him, knowing him that he's a fantastic orator who can definitely give directions to the thought processes. Sir, we are just celebrating 1 year of Motor Vehicle Amendment Act 2019. How do you see its role and contribution towards road safety as a whole, towards transportation and towards saving lives? Gadkariji?
Is also a big challenge. Because in Indian situation, we have a federal system. We need cooperation from the state government. But I will appreciate the cooperation of all the state government, particularly Tamil Nadu government is doing already an excellent job. They reduced road accident and death by 25% with the cooperation of World Bank. Their contribution is very good. Regarding this act also, we need to have intelligent traffic system. With that, we can control the traffic and we will implement the rules of the road. That is also important. We are already in the process of making of all sophisticated arrangements, making of intelligent traffic system. The public awareness and education is very important. I always say to the people that 4 E's of road safety are very important. One is engineering, education, empowerment, and emergency care. These are the 4 important E's of the road safety. And we are already working on it. And I am very much positive about the implementation of this act. At the same time, our target is to reduce 50% death. Now, India has 2 lakhs at 50,000 death. For 2030, our vision is to reduce the deaths and accidents by 50%. So I am confident that we will complete this target for 25. We are on the fast mode and we are trying our level best, and with the cooperation of the stakeholders like state government, we will achieve this goal and we will reduce the number of accidents and number of deaths.
Thank you, sir. My next question is an outcome of your opening statement, in fact, regarding states. We all know that some states have implemented it and some enforcing it, and some states have not, in fact. Sir, do you have a side of MoRTH in terms of stakeholder consultations or some kind of initiatives, incentives for the state to actually come on board and implement this and enforce this particular act so that it becomes a national movement rather than a state-wise movement?
Actually, we need cooperation from the all stakeholders. Particularly, we need cooperation from the universities, educational institutions, NGOs, and the government authorities, state governments. Plan a road safety council. Also, we are now planning on that. The most important thing is already we have appointed a committee under the chairmanship of a member of parliament in every district. My suggestion to you that you should make a follow-up of it. And now that committee is supposed to identify the black spots in the districts, by which they can identify the black spots. Some of the black spots are on national highway. Only in national highway, out of 1,50,000 deaths, 53,000 deaths are on national highway. So now we are making identifying the black spots, and already we have submitted a scheme to World Bank and ADB. It is with the now final approval of the finance ministry, the scheme is pending, where they are getting loan from ADB and World Bank, 7,000 crore from ADB and 7,000 crore from World Bank. So by this loan, 100% we are going to spend this amount on improvement of black spots. Now the problem is that I need the cooperation of member of parliament who are here, I am seeing, and I'm the transport minister. They have already identified the black spots. They have already spent 20,000 crores on improvement of black spots. But still, we need to do more work on that. For that reason, identification of black spots is very important. So presently, we are already taking a lot of projects, and where our PD is now authorized that he can take the decision and it can make improve the black spot the amount less than 50 crores. So now the problem is that identification of black spot on national highway, and we need to improve that. The other important thing is there are black spots on state roads, district roads, and the municipal corporation roads. So my suggestion is where we need public awareness, public consciousness, and public support, and also the support from the legislator, the member of the legislative assembly, member of parliaments, member of municipal councils, that is the public committee, for removing the black spots. So my suggestion is the committee under the chairmanship of member of parliament, who is a member from that district, where other member of parliament of Rajya Sabha, and also they are also the co-member of the committee. My suggestion is every month or 2 months, here the collector is the secretary of the committee. So he is supposed to organize the meeting, and he should take the review of black spots. This can be a good way where we can implement the thing. The other important thing is some of the chief minister is awarding this chief minister road safety award. The Rajasthan chief minister has already awarded, declared, and the district will be ranked on 100 point scale on 4E, that engineering and emergency care. The other important thing is we need cooperation from the automobile manufacturing industry, the NGO, medical institution. My suggestion is the public movement creating consciousness as well as social responsibility between the people is very important. For as far as the medical facility or lot of things, we have taken as some good decision. We have just taken a decision for the road accident. Taken a decision that whenever there is an accident is there, immediately we will help two victims immediately from NHI, and that amount is actually we need a cashless treatment for accident victims. We have already designed, we are in the process of designing a scheme that will provide cashless trauma care treatment for road accident victims at the nearest appropriate hospital in accordance with the Supreme Court ruling. It is on national highway. I am expecting this cooperation from the state government also on state highways. We will be providing an end-to-end treatment where the accident and the claims will be funded by our ministry and settled with the national health authority. This is a very important step in terms of providing assurance and SOS services for national highway, making it even more safer. This future can be very well integrated with our new greenfield and access control express highway, such as Delhi to Mumbai, where citizens can travel without having to worry about their safety. So this is a new initiative taken by the ministry, and my suggestion is the other state government, they can take the same initiative for the state road. It can be a really good thing. I'm giving you an example of Tamil Nadu, that Tamil Nadu showed the maximum number of reduction of 24% accidents and death. And it is really a remarkable contribution from the Tamil Nadu. Similarly, in Maharashtra, our reports towards road safety showed a massive reduction of 2,792 accidents. In West Bengal, 2,547 accidents. Andhra Pradesh, 2,483 accidents, and Gujarat, 1,723 accidents. Only in these five states, we saw a massive reduction of nearly 17,000 accidents due to reports of road safety. This is really a good thing. I appreciate it. But we need to do more for that. Similarly, all the other states are doing very well towards making efforts to reduce road accidents. And now, in 2019 alone, we were able to save 1,691 lives in Tamil Nadu, 606 lives in Gujarat, and 743 lives in Maharashtra, and 227 lives in Delhi, and 215 lives in Punjab. Combined together in 2019, we were able to save nearly 3,200 lives from getting arrested due to accidents. It's good motivation to work even more harder in this space to reduce the number of deaths due to road accidents. This is really a good thing. The most important thing is we are losing 3% of the GDP because of our road accident. So my suggestion to all state governments, all MP, member of parliament, ministers of the state governments, then public representative from municipal corporations, NGOs, educational institutions, all of the stakeholders, we need more strong campaign for that to create awareness in the mind of the people. And I am confident that it is not only possible with government, but with the cooperation of the all public representatives on different levels, NGOs, educational institutions, automobile manufacturing industries, and media. By taking the help of the stakeholders, we will be in position to save the life of the people. So this is a public movement, and we need cooperation from everybody. I am also one of the victims. My family faced a very serious accident when I was leader of opposition in Maharashtra. I am very much sensitive about it. I am ready to do whatever you suggest me for saving the life of the people. This is a very, very sensitive subject, cutting to my heart. And I am ready to help anywhere, anything for saving the life of the people. And giving thanks to your organization that you are also taking this program, you are creating awareness in the mind of people. And giving my member of parliament present in this seminar, really, it is really, your contribution is very, very good. I really appreciate it. And I will request you to take more initiative where I am ready. By this way, we can save the life of the people in our country. And our target is to reduce this accident and death target 50% by 2030. But I am confident that people like you will support me 100% before 2025, we will achieve this goal. I will request from my core of my heart that we should do all effort to save the life of the people in the road accident.
Thank you, sir, for elaborate understanding of the government role. I think you mentioned very clearly a role of cooperation and coordination. I think that is very critical, in fact. Sir, just wanted to point out here that during the COVID, we have seen that there is a kind of a disconnect between the road safety angle and the transportation angle, where the Ministry of Home Affairs is working for one direction, MoRTH is working in another. Obviously, the parent ministry, in fact, and in trauma care, obviously, the health ministry is also working in that direction. The question asked is by Times of India, in fact, and I would like to repeat here that this particular coordination is something which is very important. I mean, as a coordinating agency, where does the states and the centers coordination actually come in terms of stakeholder meetings, in terms of consultations, in terms of investments being made towards a particular directions? If you could basically just highlight some of the areas where the state-central cooperation can be better understood by most of us, sir.
Actually, in the period of COVID, the accident percentage and the death percentage is very much reduced. And air pollution also, the problem is now is not very much. But one thing I will suggest you, there are a lot of people doing a lot of experiments and initiatives in a different way. The mission is same, the target is same, but how we can save the life of the people, how we can reduce the number of accidents. So they are working in the same direction. I don't feel that there is any contradiction between it. Even we have a discussion with all the stakeholders, and the state government is also taking a lot of good initiative. I just give you the example of Rajasthan government. My only suggestion is, what I feel is, there is a social deterrent force in media. Take the preventive care, preventive measures, that those who can ask the question to every member of parliament, you can ask me the question to me also, what you are doing, what the other member of parliaments are doing, whether the committee is formed or not, Apagata Nivaran Samiti, Accident Removal Committee, and a parliament member is the member, whether they are taking meetings or not, whether they identify black spots or not. If say a one place where 10, 20, 25 deaths are taken place, still there is no action from the ascending authority. So it is the time for the public to take action against them. Even the police commissioner, the SP, are the member of the committee. So my suggestion is, through your side, you can create pressure on public representative, pressure on administration, paper on different agents, pressure on different agency. It can create more awareness, and which is very important. The state government should promote the good sanitation provision in the Motor Vehicle Amendment Act. This will help in motivating citizens to care forward and help victims. So that is also very important. What my suggestion is, what my feeling is, this is a serious problem. We need more cooperation, more sensitiveness, more awareness from the public representatives, from the society, from the education institutions, from the media, from the NGOs, and from the administration. Everywhere, from central government to state government to up to a small stakeholder, we need to increase the speed of our initiative and effort we are taking for that. That is very important. For that reason, what I will request you, you need to ask every member of parliament that whether your committee is formed or not, what is your problem. Even you can check the my ministry also, whether what they are doing, what are the problems, where they are stuck up. This type of awareness and positivity is going to create more. And that is need of our, and that is what we need for the awareness in the society.
Connected to that particular question is, again, to answer is, again, something that, I mean, what we call as, sir, which is a smart move, in fact, which is specific, measurable, achievable, realistic, and time bound. I'm relating this to the highways, in specifically, since they come under MoRTH and FRAC specifically. So when we see that, you know, that the highways actually account for 2% or 3% of the roads and has a major share of 35% of the accidents, in fact, what are the steps that is MoRTH taking to actually make highways safer? Because on one hand, we have allowed more speed on the highways, or the and basically the roads and the pedestrian ways on highways are in a very poor state, in fact, and in most of the places. Sir, you specifically had mentioned in one of the earlier discussions, in fact, that a lot of emphasis has been put on, obviously, making the express highways and other arterial roads, in fact. So where do we actually stand in today's context about highways? Because that is the next generation transport way. So what is it that we can possibly do to reduce accidents on the highways?
First of all, we have increased the highway construction. When I was taken charge as a minister, it was coming to 2 kilometers per day. But now in COVID period also, we are in the process of 30 kilometers per day. So the way in which we are, construction is going on, I'm confident that within 2 years, the total picture of national highway will change in the country. Now you take example of Delhi. The Delhi peripheral road, ring road, is completed. Actually, this road case was in the Supreme Court. Because there we need the cooperation of Uttar Pradesh, Haryana, Delhi, and the all government, and there was a big problem. But we resolved the issue and the road is completed. That only one road is going to produce a lot of accidents in Delhi. And now we are making the road from Delhi to Mumbai. We can take you from Delhi to Mumbai by 12 hours. This is a 12-lane cement concrete road, 8-lane access control road. Just I am giving you an example. We are making Meerut Delhi. Now, from January, we are going to inaugurate this road. Presently, it takes 4.5 hours from coming from Meerut to Delhi. But after this, we will take you within 45 minutes from Meerut to Delhi. We are making Delhi, Amritsar, Katra, Bangalore, Chennai. Lot of roads, we are 22 green express highway we are making. So by this construction of this road, 100% we are spending 5 lakhs crore on this 22 green express highway. And I am confident that by this highway, we are going to reduce traffic congestion, not only traffic congestion, but we will reduce the number of accidents. So this is to be a remarkable and historical work is already going on. I am confident that in Northeast, in Assam, in Punjab, Haryana, Rajasthan, Jammu Kashmir, everywhere we are doing lot of work. We are in Uttarakhand making Char Dham project. And that project is making new roads that will stop. We will save the life of the people that will be all season road to Badrinath, Kedarnath, Gangotri and Yamunotri. Out of 54 packages, 40 packages have already awarded. And today it is a pleasure for me that Supreme Court has cleared the case. So the 13 projects we will award immediately, and that will resolve the problem. So my suggestion is black spots are improving. Trauma center, we are not good success rate on that. SOS and ambulance services also, it's not also to the satisfactory mark which I expected. But the black spot identification, vehicle safety standards, we are taking special care for that. Even for economic models also, now the rules and law which is clear that you have to take the all measure as far as the safety is concerned. Making BIS standards compulsory of all helmets, then evacuation of drivers to screening and psychological training, vehicle fitness training centers. My suggestion to all of you, that we, for all members of parliament, that you take the initiative, we want to start driving training center every district. So we are ready to support you. From the private organization and NGOs, if we can submit the scheme, we are ready to support them financially. In India, presently, we have a shortage of 22 lakh drivers. So my suggestion is on all this line, even we can work, we can resolve this issue.
A valid question would be in that some of the states who have actually not implemented this particular act, in fact, and 1 year has passed. What is the initiative of the central government to actually nudge the states to act, react, and enforce, I mean, implement and enforce? Is a possibility where I'm again coming back to that particular point that is that a possibility that it can become a national agenda? And the states can be brought on board now that we have crossed the 1 year mark also?
Actually, frankly speaking, we have a federal system. We cannot impose any state government. But the act passed by the parliament, it is supported by all political parties. There was a lot of reservation, a lot of confusion about this act in the mind of the people. We don't want to take any authority, we don't want to take any rights from the state government. But the act is well appreciated by all the stakeholders on the international level. My suggestion to all of you that please convince the state governments, state transport ministers, to accept the act and implement that. Because there is a provision, and sometimes it is misinterpreted in media. Actually, the fine is taking for next 20 years. So it is not meaningful that you are taking the fine amount. Whatever is your effort is taking up to 20 years, you can make that amount this year. That is not to be expected from us. There is a right of the state government to decide the amount from 500 to 5,000 rupees. So they can make it 600, 800, 1,000. So some of the state government, if there is a problem, even in the act, from the central government side, I am ready for open discussion. I want to support them. I want to help them. And with the cooperation of all the state government, our intention is to save the life of the people and reduce the number of accidents. My suggestion is, people like you, if you can make discussion with the state government and request them to implement this act, this can be a great thing for the life of the people in the country. And that is very important for all of us.
Thank you, sir. We are working in many states and we are trying to convince them, and definitely some kind of intervention from the central government would help us actually move forward. We are always with MOT, and we're trying to convince states. Sir, one of the questions that has come up repeatedly is the safe systems approach, which basically includes all stakeholders on the roads. In fact, we are too actually obsessed with the motorized vehicles and roads. So this particular safe system approach obviously means we are talking about pedestrian, we are talking of cyclists, we are talking of all types of movements on either highways or stateways. In fact, what is your opinion about safe system?
We are encouraging people for using cycles. We are in the, you just take an example of the Delhi Meerut Express Highway near Swaminarayan Mandir. We are making a provision for pedestrian and for cycle also there is a provision. So but the land is a big problem. So everywhere our idea is to taking the preventive measures as far as the pedestrians' rights, which are very important, and we are very conscious and sensitive about it. But the problem in the area is somewhere there is encroachment. The footpaths are encroached by small shopkeepers. There is a problem that we need strong political will from the municipal corporation and collector and police corps. We cannot. So, in which we need to have some fruit and vegetable markets, mutton much markets in the city. That now presently the people are sitting on the road. It is also a big problem. Some of the cities where we need ring road, we are missing from NHS a lot of ring roads. We probably need cooperation from the state government. But this is a very complicated problem. But we need to create awareness in the mind of the people. And in Indian democratic system, there are a lot of stakeholders. We have already accepted the federal constitution. So the state government rights, and they're equally important, respect them. So ultimately, only I will request to all authorities like municipal corporation and Jilla Panchayat, even for Gram Panchayat, and even to the state government, that we have to take it seriously. And as a stakeholder, we can come together, think together, and work together to establish cooperation, coordination, and communication. And we need to work only in the interest of the people, that how we can save the life of the people and how we can reduce the accidents. And this is the feeling, there is no political dispute on this subject, whatever the parties we may have. But we should work in the line of this line. I feel that it can be a direction to all the people, where 100% we can reduce the accident and save the life of the people. On above politics, now in the 5 lakhs accident and 1 lakh death, it is really a shameful for the country. So my request to all of you, that we need to reduce this number. And that is a national challenge. This is not a political subject. This is a challenge for the country, challenge for people, and challenge for all stakeholders. I feel that with the cooperation of all the stakeholders, like state government, the ministers, MLA, MPs, education institutions, NGOs, universities, school, colleges, and creating awareness, 100% on the principle of four principles: education, enforcement, engineering, and emergency medical services. The fourth thing we need to improve, and 100% we will achieve our goal.
One last question, but a very important question is, you have always stretched upon the PPP model for going forward as far as transportation and road safety both are concerned. In fact, this PPP model basically, has been successful in many states, and obviously it's a success model as far as national highways are concerned. So, what are we looking for? Some of the models which can be standardized and passed across to the state governments for building their roads in terms of designing, in terms of infrastructure, in terms of certain layouts. And designing part is a critical part of the entire thing. Where the PPP model, we have deterrents now on in the act, of course, but then can we actually ensure that the same can be sent to the states as a hand-holding exercise? Where the PPP models works there also, in fact, based on the experience now that MORTH has gathered after your working with the PPP model for quite some time now.
Your point is very important, because I am the first person in the country who started PPP road construction in the country. The first project in the country on national highway, that is Thane-Bhiwandi bypass in Mumbai, that was constructed on BOT basis, the first road project when I was minister in Maharashtra. And with this experience at that time, I got appointed to construct Mumbai-Pune Express Highway, 55 flyovers in Mumbai, and Varli-Bandra ceiling project. Now you are absolutely correct, because our state governments are facing a lot of financial constraints. Even the central government is facing the constraint. And now, even because of COVID-19 also, we are in a very stressed position economically. So this is the time that we should go for PPP model. When I was in London, I visited London Transport and lot of institute there. I was very much impressed. And there was a lot of ideas where we can develop on PPP more. And I have got a lot of ideas in my mind. So today, what I can do, that we will appoint a private consultant, a good reputed company, to study how we can make PPP model in this particularly our transport system, intelligent traffic system, in the state level, or in a municipal corporation level, or even on the national highway level. And we will formulate the tender by which whatever the fines we are getting, the infrastructure will be created by the private people, and whatever the fine we will get it, that fine out of which some percentage will be contributed for getting that capital cost back. So on the basis of that, we can make some models. Today it is really an important subject, and I'm thankful to you that immediately I will give instruction to my department to make a policy of PPP models from a special competent consultant, by which we can offer the policy to the state government that how they can march ahead towards taking PPP mode into consideration without investment of capital costs. They can control the thing and we can achieve the goal. So I will work on it. My suggestion to all of you, if you have any idea in your mind regarding PPP model in public intelligent traffic system, for the corporation, for the state highway, for the national highway, anywhere, kindly give your young talented boy, Mr. Joshi, is here, and he's second merit in London School of Economics. And now I am already giving him an advisory job in my ministry. He's working on these all these models, and he's experienced in London. So he knows the London transport model, London intelligent traffic system model, and know the model of international standards. So on the basis of that, my suggestion is, please give me the suggestion, and 100% we will implement. Because one fact is very clear, that we have in the state government, financial constraints are there. So without, by taking private public investment on PPP mode, we can go ahead and we can save the life of the people and we can save the government budgetary money also, and we will resolve this issue. Your suggestion is very important, and I will work on it, and we will make the policy. Even we will make the ideal tender terms and conditions, and giving this advisory to the state government that on this line, without investing money from the state budget, you can get the achieve the goal. So 100% I will support that, and I will do it.
Thank you very much, sir. I'm being greedy, but this is definitely one of the last questions. In fact, and you've just heard our international speakers speaking about it. So we are working in India along with international experts and along with GRSP, GHAI, and Bloomberg Philanthropies, and the Road Safety Coalition, of course, the network is, empowered with certain knowledge which can be imparted, in fact. So I would be looking forward to hearing from you how we can be of important, contributor to the entire system of MOAT implementing its programs as a group which has got international support, technical, non-technical training, everything is with us, in fact. And I would like to hear from you as the last question, in fact, for the day. I know I'm getting late, in fact, but it is important for us to understand where do the international best practices and how do we bring it into India through MOAT officially?
Actually, when I was Minister for Rural Development, at that time, I floated one idea, that is Bank of Ideas, Innovation and Research. And today also in MSME also we have started. But now with your question, it's a good idea in my mind, and I will immediately give instruction to my department. We will make a bank of ideas and innovation regarding how we can make road safety and saving the life of the people and reduce the road accident. We can start a special portal for that. And that portal will be open for every citizen of this country, and we will receive the suggestions from them. And 100% we can, even my suggestion for the state government to open such a portal, and they will receive the suggestions. And on the basis of that, the accidents or everything will be monitoring. We will monitor everything in this thing, and we will take the immediate decision as far as the good suggestion given by the people by and large. So immediately I am giving my instruction to my people that we can make bank of ideas, innovation and research for reducing road accidents and how we save the life of the people. And that is the spirit by which we can take the suggestion from all the people, and we will definitely make the thing. My other suggestion is also we have to work on international level. There are some countries where accidents percentage is negligible. Some countries, there is a zero. So people like me, who can get the experience of success story of this country, how they reduce the accident and how they save the life of the people. On the basis of that, if you can do, make the study and research of it. On the basis of that, if you can give suggestion to state government and state government, it can be also a good idea, which can be a good vision for all of us, because no one is perfect and no one can claim that he is perfect. So this is the time, whatever the good successful in the whole world or saving the life of the people and living the accident, is a time for India also to accept that good suggestions and recommendations, or exactly our mission is how we can save the life of the people and living the accident. The people like you, the NGOs, the institutions, the university, the research people, the expert people, I will suggest them that you make a study of all the successful practices of the countries, those who are doing excellent job. On the basis of that, please suggest us and giving us an idea by which 100% we will implement that. That is very much useful to the country.
Thank you, Gadkari, for spending so much of time and answering so many questions. Despite your ill health, I know you're not keeping too well. In fact, thank you for being a part of our session and with the Honorable MPs the Honorable Transport Ministers of various states. In fact, I hope you're going to be with us for the next sessions as we continue this particular webinar forward. Thank you from all of us, in fact, in India, from the webinar, present in the webinar and present everywhere. And I believe there are thousands of people watching us, and that's the message that came in, in fact. So it's I think you are addressing a very, very key event today after a long time in terms of road safety and transportation, which has been our idea so far. In fact, it's not about just 1 year. There'll be many more years which will pass by, but then we must achieve our goals every year, step by step. Thank you again, and thank you for being with us. And we will continue with our next sessions of with the Honorable MPs. And to take it over from me from here will be Saroja from Civic Action Group, Chennai, in fact. So it's over to you, Saroja, for a session with the Honorable Members of Parliament, including, everybody you know, in fact. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ashim. Good afternoon, everyone. I welcome you all to this session on road safety and policy reforms. As we all agree, periodical policy reforms are necessary to deal with emerging issues in the ever-changing world. The Motor Vehicle Amendment Act is one such proposal legislation that aims to strengthen road safety in India. There are several provisions in the Act that will go a long way in saving lives on roads if implemented effectively. To share their views on the NVAA's impact on road safety and the way forward, we are joined by esteemed members of Parliament, Dr. Vinay Sahasrabuddhe, Rajya Sabha MP from Maharashtra, and Chairman Select Committee on Motor Vehicles Amendment Bill, Shri Bhubaneswar Kalita, Rajya Sabha MP from Assam, Shri KPS Tulsi, Rajya Sabha MP from Chhattisgarh, Shri Bajayan Panda, he is the National Vice President and Spokesperson of BJP from Odisha, who are champions of road safety and extend their unconditional support to the cause. We welcome you all, sir. Thank you for sparing your valuable time and joining us today. So we are given 35 minutes for this session. And I thought we'll have two rounds of questions, sir. The first one will be common to all of you. The question goes like this. How do you think that NVAA has impacted road safety in 1 year? What else should be done to make it more effective? Dr. Vinay Sahasrabuddhe, would you like to respond to this, sir? Dr. Vinay?
I think he's offline. Pass on the question.
Okay. Sir, Mr. Kalita, would you like to respond to this? Mr. Bhubaneswar Kalita? Over to you, Mr. Tulsi. Thank you. Yes.
I would like to say that, firstly, thank you very much for having me here. And I'm glad that I get to speak on my favorite subject. In 1975, when I was only 5 years at the bar, I had written a book on Tulsi's Digest of Accident Claims Cases, where we had analyzed the accident cases of all the countries. But India, of course, still continues to have a dubious distinction of 5 lakh road crashes every year, in which 1.5 lakh lives are lost. But I think our emphasis has to be of being able to provide medical facility urgently, because more people die of loss of blood on the roads, and nobody wants to stop because they are worried that the police will implicate them. I have many a times reported that there is an accident which has taken place, and then you are made to stay there till the FIR is done, till the postmortem is done, etc. So we need to clarify that the merely because somebody is reporting an accident, he can't be implicated in this fashion. These days, you can have their identity established and let them go. Unless people are encouraged, because we will never have enough facilities for on the spot for making available the medical facility within 15 or 20 minutes. There will be local people who will be able to help, but they are afraid of action being taken against them. The other is we need to, far as cities are concerned on BRT, this BRT model was on the basis of the National Transport Policy, where it was the endeavor of the government was that you need to encourage public transport and make public transport more efficient, more comfortable. And you want to discourage personal transport. Now, BRT has been a huge success in some of the states. And I think that unless BRT is there where people are made to induce to switch over from personal transport to public transport, like metro is so, but we're talking about the road transport. Road transport also needs to take forward. I'm glad that there has been some amendment about making the offense of rash and negligent driving punishable, but at the moment it's punishable only with 2 years, and it's not even a non-bailable offense, it's a bailable offense. We need to see as to how we can deal with the accidents, because particularly drunken driving is unforgivable. A person is using the transport which has turned into a murder weapon. And many a times then, when these kind of drunken driving per se is criminal, and it can be punished with far more than only 2 years. I would like to say that I am greatly impressed with this desire of the minister that we should establish drivers training centers. If our local area development fund is restored, I would like to establish at least 10 of them in Chhattisgarh, and one in every district. And we can. I'm glad that people are being encouraged to do this, and thank you very much. I don't think I have more time available so far as the webinar is concerned.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Panda?
Thank you. I would like to thank the organizers for this very important virtual gathering, and we heard some very important statements by the minister. I'd also like to thank all the attendees, particularly my colleagues from Parliament and from the various state governments and from the political arena, who will have such an important influence in how we improve our road safety profile. It's been my pleasure to have been associated with some of the organizations present today for some road safety campaigns. In fact, I've been involved in various road safety campaigns since my 20s, since I was personally involved in an accident which was borderline from becoming serious. Your question was the impact of the Motor Vehicles Act changes that have taken place since the last 1 year. As some of the other people have said, I want to emphasize that it has been a major inflection point. It's a very positive thing. Now, of course, there are hurdles, there are difficulties, but let me tell you why it is important. Because it came after 3 decades. It came after 3 decades from the earlier situation. And many of us, including almost everybody present today, had been campaigning for some of these aspects for years and years and years. Now, in a democratic system, there is always give and take, and what we end up with is not necessarily perfect, but it is the most optimal situation. We have heard about some of the difficulties, like some of the states not implementing and some reservations from other quarters. But overall, the amendment, the passed by Parliament, has been a huge step forward for two reasons. Number one, it has brought the dialogue front and center, because for a few weeks last year, we saw people being slapped with very heavy fines. And there was a reaction. Many people supported the heavy fines. Some people said it's too harsh. But whatever it is, this topic came to the forefront that we cannot afford to be losing 1.5 lakh people every year, 1.5 lakh Indians and 3% of GDP to road accidents, and the 500,000 people that get injured from it. So bringing this topic to the front and center was the biggest contribution of this new act. Now, secondly, the act has become implemented in various parts. In Delhi itself, I know it has had some impact, and other parts. So as the Honorable Minister was saying, it's not something, we are not a country where a union government can give a diktat and all the rules will fall into place across the country. So we need to get buy-in from the states particularly. I'm glad that so many state ministers and former ministers are present here. It is incumbent on all of us to champion the cause. It is incumbent to explain to the public why this is necessary. And it is incumbent to explain that as India grows further, you know, we are already the fifth largest economy in the world. We are heading towards becoming the third largest economy in a foreseeable future. It will mean more roads. It will mean no matter how much we improve our public transport, and we are improving with metros and other things, as Tulsi Saab was saying. The fact is that we also need to improve our culture, our commitment to the rules and regulations. People who are used to an Indian way of driving on a single lane today are driving on 8-lane highways with the same habits. And that can only change by incentives and disincentives in the rules. So as more and more people start using vehicles on highways in parts of India which have never seen a highway before, we will have this risk unless we push this forward. So to conclude, the act has been a watershed. But of course, it is. We have made two steps forward and one step back because of the pushback. This is only normal, only to be expected, but that is still a gain. Now, this is how we will progress. We must all get committed that if we can make every year, we can go two steps forward and one step back. That's not a bad thing. Over a course of 5 years, as the Honorable Minister was saying, we can cut down the fatalities by 50%. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Very nicely put. Thank you. Mr. Tulsi, my question to you, sir, being a senior advocate of the Supreme Court and former Additional Solicitor General of India. So, is it legal for the states to? Is it legal for the states to not implement the act or amend provisions beyond the scope of the law? And what are the options before the center to ensure compliance? Hello.
I'm sorry. I think the picture.
Should I repeat? Okay, so before he comes back, Mr. Panda, my question to you, sir, that you mentioned earlier also about you have defined road accidents as an economic tragedy.
I'm sorry, I'm not able to hear you. Would you please ensure the other mics are muted? Otherwise, there is crosstalk and I'm not able to hear you.
I request everyone to be on mute, please. What is happening? So you good? Mr. Tulsi? So Mr. Panda, you had defined road accidents as an enormous economic tragedy, apart from it being a human tragedy. Would you like to elaborate on this, please?
Yes, in fact, in some of the articles that I have written and speeches I have made, I have spoken about this. I'm very glad that Honorable Minister Shri Gadkari ji also referred to this issue when he said that 3% of GDP is lost due to our road accidents. Now, let's remember, India has, I think, the largest number of fatalities, largest road accidents in the world. I mean, considering we are a large country, we have some of that burden is there, but even considering that, we are very high. So we are still a developing country. We are at the entry level of middle income countries, and we are certainly not in a position to be superficial or casual about any loss of economic growth, particularly now after the past 6 months, when this global pandemic has hurt all countries and has hurt India economically quite badly. So there is an economic argument apart from the human angle. Of course, the human angle is the most important aspect, but the economic argument is critical because 3% is a huge number of GDP. Even in the recent decades when we have done very well economically, that is about 50% of the kind of growth we have been getting every year. So we must do everything to ensure that reduce or eliminate these road accidents, so that even if it adds another 1.5-2% to our GDP growth rate every year, that makes a very, very big difference. And it also has other related impacts, because in terms of medical costs, in terms of the pressure on the healthcare systems, in terms of the hugely disruptive effect it has on families who lose members. You know, if you're losing such a large number of citizens every year, it has very disruptive effects. So some of the aspects that have been brought about, such as Good Samaritan laws, need to become widespread. We've seen the success of some of that in some parts of India. We need to push that very, very widely. I'm very glad that this focus has been sustained over the last many years, particularly over the last 1 year. And I would urge everyone participating here, not just the organizations who are dedicating full time to this mission, but all the policymakers who are present here, to devote chunks of time to make sure that this remains top of mind, so that we can bring these regulatory and cultural changes around in the next few years.
You're muted, Saroja.
Thank you, Ranjit. I was just saying, looks like we have lost Mr. Tulsi. So, Mr. Panda, I'm going to bombard you with a couple of other questions as well. So my next question to you is, sir,
I'm running over time because this is running late, and I had another commitment, so I need to leave in about 5 minutes. So why don't we do one thing? Why don't you give me two questions and I'll answer both of them, and so that I can leave in the next 5 minutes.
Sure, sir. So the next question is, 2/3 of riders are vulnerable group and contribute to 1/3 of fatalities in the country, the two-wheeler riders. Yet there is steadfast reluctance to wear helmets mandated by law. Now the NDAA 2019 requires all riders over the age of 4 to wear helmets. What needs to be done to improve compliance with the helmet rule? So I know that as far as awareness goes, government and CSOs have been carrying out awareness campaigns on helmets for several years now. and people are aware, still there is reluctance. What is the reason, and what should be done about this is one. And the second is, like, I would like to know what role MPs play at state level for effective enforcement of the law.
Okay, both are very important questions. Let me tell you, you're absolutely right that the reluctance to wear helmets is causing a disproportionate amount of harm to more vulnerable sections. Now, again, this is something typical. We should expect this and we should work on eliminating it. Some of the other campaigns I have worked with, some of the organizers of this event involve, for example, anti-tobacco action. There also, it's the most vulnerable people who get affected most, who don't have the ability to have medical insurance and things like that. Of course, today there is a nationwide medical insurance, but vulnerable people, because the people in the lower income categories are not in four-wheelers, which are inherently more safe than two-wheelers. So about the helmet question, again, it's a cultural issue. It's not just a regulatory, it is also a regulatory issue, because we need local authorities and traffic police to crack down on it. You see that happen from time to time in various towns and cities and villages, but not on a consistent basis. So a few times a year, they will have a camp and they will stop two-wheeler riders and fine them. But if the fines are significant, then only it will be taken seriously. And if it is not just a few times a year, but on a regular basis, you do it, then people will get used to it. But I would like to add one more aspect. I myself ride a motorcycle quite frequently in rural areas when I travel in my constituency, quite extensively. And I find in Indian conditions, helmets can be extremely uncomfortable, because when I'm going around and the outside temperature is 47 degrees and it's extremely high humidity, this is one of the deterrents. So I'm urging people to find a technical solution. Maybe there are solutions which can allow ventilation in helmets to improve the comfort level, because I can speak from the perspective of a user, because I experience the difficulty of using helmets. So this may be one of the aspects contributing to some of the cultural factors. But without a doubt, we need to bring about very high compliance levels of helmets, because two-wheelers are not going away anywhere. They are going to be the fastest growing segment of personal transport over the next generation, over the next 25, 30 years. So we do need to focus on this enormously. The second question you asked is, what can MPs do? Now, this is also an interesting and important question, because sometimes people have unrealistic expectations of lawmakers, because lawmakers don't have direct executive authority. You can't ask an MP and say that, look, why can't we just issue a diktat? We are not an authoritarian country. That's not how the system works. MPs don't have the power to just issue a diktat. It's a long, arduous process to get laws changed. Just like we saw, after three decades, the act was changed with a lot of input from all of you activists and lawmakers and policymakers. So I have two suggestions what MPs can do. MPs can accelerate the process in parliament, and MLAs can do the same in assemblies by filing private members' bills. Private members' bills, if you can get enough support and enough publicity, start putting immense pressure on the legislature and the government to start making changes to the law and the regulations. So that is one way. You can ask questions, you can raise the statistics, you can make interventions for short duration discussions. But beyond that, since this is a federal issue, it also has to be taken up at state level, as Honorable Minister was pointing out. MPs have a platform which they can use for various issues. Many times you'll see MPs voicing issues of whatever is pertinent or immediately urgent. It could be the economy, it could be border clashes, it could be natural disasters. But I don't think enough of us MPs raise topics like road safety, which are not top of mind. So I would urge to use the platform of being an MP or an ex-MP or a minister or an ex-minister. If you go and make a statement down in your home, it's bound to get carried. It is bound to have some impact. It is bound to help drive one more nail in the coffin of the old culture which tolerates ki ye chalta hai, ye theek hai, this is how India is, it cannot change. We need to end that culture. So to use the soapbox, to use the public platform that we get as public representatives outside of assembly or outside of parliament is equally important as the steps we can take inside the legislature, which I was just pointing out. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Can I ask you just one more question, if you don't mind, please?
I need to leave. I'll take a very quick one.
Yeah. So just one question, sir. Why is there reluctance on part of some states to actually notify the provisions of the NDAA?
Again, this is a good question. But again, I will come back to saying something which I have said twice before already, that we should expect some of these things as natural because it's human nature. In democracies, governments are tuned towards the public mood, public opinion. Public opinion is that this is inconvenience. And public opinion, in general, people support the idea that yes, we must have road safety. But in particular, when it applies to yourself, they say, hey, this is a very high fine. It's not reasonable. People are lower income category. So it's quite natural for government to respond to public mood. Now, if we don't expect that, if we are not anticipating that, that means we are not doing our job properly. Now, what I would suggest is we should get pushback even by reasonable people, even by people who broadly, generally support the idea of road safety, even people who in theory have always supported that, yes, there should be strict penalties. When it actually comes to them and it happens to them or a family member, they will react negatively, say, hey, this is inconvenience. This is not fair. So we should anticipate that. And our communications efforts, our efforts to change this culture must be tuned towards that. So we should speak about this. We should speak about how many people who support when push comes to shove, they hold back. And we must point out that these temporary inconveniences, no matter even if they are quite harsh, are extremely important. You know, we need to have advertising campaigns. I remember I told you about my accident when I was in my 20s. I was at that time living in the US, and there were some campaigns which showed, you know, just like on tobacco campaigns, you have pretty gory photographs on tobacco packages. Similarly, there were campaigns, advertising campaigns showing what can happen if you fall off a two-wheeler without wearing a helmet. What can happen in an accident if you are not wearing a seatbelt? They're quite graphic videos and graphic photographs, but they're effective in hitting home that it is not worth risking your child's life for this inconvenience or for this harsh penalty. You should accept it as a necessary tool for changing the culture. So again, it is incumbent on us to anticipate these pushbacks and to communicate to help change the culture.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. I'll take leave of you.
Thanks.
A big thank you to Saroja and to all the honorable MPs and to specifically to our a supporter who we can never ever forget, and that is Mr. Panda. In fact, for all the projects that we are doing, he takes personal interest. Thank you so much for being with us and actually spending more time than you committed. Thank you so much.
Thank
we
you.
Move
thank
over to the next session along with my colleague of the Road Safety Network, and that is basically the session with the road transport ministers, and we have Mr. George Charian, of Director of CUTS, to lead this session. Over to you, George.
Thanks, Ashim. Good afternoon, everyone. Glad to be part of this event celebrating the 1 year of Road Motor Vehicle Act in the country. This act, as all of you know, is very important because of three reasons. One is, in any country, strengthening the law is the first step in the right direction, which we have done. Second thing, this passage of this act was the culmination of a five-year process going through the group of ministers, then the parliamentary standing committee, then the Rajya Sabha select committee, a very elaborate consultation with all the stakeholders taking their views on board. Third thing, this Motor Worker Act also was amending, complete overhauling after a period of about 30 years. So this act is very there is a lot of expectation that it will be contributing towards addressing the road accidents and the fatalities in this country. I'm not taking more time for introduction. We have two prominent people to speak in this particular session. One is Sri Yunus Khan, who is the former chairperson of the group of ministers or chairperson of the group of ministers and former minister of transport with the government of Rajasthan during 2013. 2018. I will ask two questions each to the Honorable Minister of Gujarat, Sri R.C. Falu, two prominent speakers we have. I will take ask two questions in the first round to each of the speakers, and then if time permit, we can have one more round of discussion. Sri Yunus Khan, sir, you were the chairperson of a group of ministers. This group of ministers was a unique approach because before the parliament debate on the bill, taking the states into confidence, taking the states on board and listening to their views. Mainly, this was attached to the National Road Safety Council to give the recommendation for the drafting of the act and also helping the ministry in the process of strengthening this law. And you have done a very elaborate process between 2016 and 2019, at least 5 meetings and an elaborate consultation. So can you share with us, sir, being the chairperson of the group of ministers, though it started with 7 ministers and 4 officials, you know, in the final count, almost 21 ministers were part of the group of ministers consultation as members or special invitees. So can you share your experience being the chairperson of this group of ministers and the unique contribution that GOM had done in strengthening this law and passage of the Motor Vehicle Act 2019. Over to you, sir. Sir, your mic is muted. Can you unmute?
Can't sir, mic unmute.
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
चेरिन साहब सुन रहे हैं मुझे
या प्लीज प्लीज
ओके सबसे पहले तो मैं माननीय नितिन गडकरी जी का आभार व्यक्त करूंगा और सानियान साहब का और आपका भी और हमारे गुजरात के मिनिस्टर साहब बैठे हैं उनको भी मैं नमस्कार करूंगा सबसे बड़ी बात यह है कि हमारा देश 199 देशों में अगर कोई चीज में प्रथम है तो वो रोड एक्सीडेंट उसकी डेथ में ये बहुत दुर्भाग्यपूर्ण बात है हमारे इतने बड़े देश के लिए कि हमारा देश मतलब सड़क दुर्घटनाओं में इतने लोग मर जाते हैं ये बहुत चिंता का विषय है और इस बात को माननीय प्रधानमंत्री नरेंद्र मोदी जी और माननीय नितिन गडकरी जी ने दोनों ने समझा और चूंकि मैं 10 साल का मेरे पास एक्सपीरियंस था एज ए ट्रांसपोर्ट मिनिस्टर आपने अभी बताया कि भी 13 से 18 में ट्रांसपोर्ट मिनिस्टर था मैं 2003 से 8 में भी ट्रांसपोर्ट का मिनिस्टर था और जब हमने ये देखा कि रोड एक्सीडेंट में बहुत सारी डेथ हो जाती है लोग मर जाते हैं और ज्यादातर जवान मौतें होती हैं अभी मैं अगर आंकड़ों की चर्चा करूँ तो अभी ये कोविड चल रहा है कोविड में आप देख लीजिए कि हमारे देश में कल शाम तक 72,296 में लोग मरे जबकि रोड एक्सीडेंट में 155,000 लास्ट ईयर अकेले एक वर्ष में मरे जो कि बहुत बड़ी मतलब जो मौतें हैं तो इसमें हम कोविड में कितने पूरा देश आर्थिक रूप से और सामाजिक रूप से परेशान है तो आप देखिए कि जिसके घर में जवान मौत होती है रोड एक्सीडेंट में वो बहुत ज्यादा परेशानी में आ जाता है एक बात दूसरी बात माननीय गडकरी जी ने कहा कि भी देश की 3% GDP भी इससे नुकसान होता है तो इन सब बातों को समझते हुए ये जिम्मेदारी मुझे दी गई और जब हमने काम किया तो उस एक्सपीरियंस के बारे में चेरियन साहब आपने कहा कि बताएं, तो ये जो हमारे 29 राज्य हैं और 7 केंद्रशासित राज्य हैं, इन सब में हमने पत्राचार के माध्यम से, टेलीफोन के माध्यम से और सब माध्यमों से संपर्क किया और मुझे खुशी है कि 29 राज्यों के तो मिनिस्टर्स ने इसमें हिस्सा लिया और उसके अलावा सभी के सभी मतलब जो है राज्यों के ऑफिसर्स भी उस मीटिंग्स में आते थे। नई दिल्ली में हमने मतलब जो है 2016 में किया, बेंगलुरु में किया, बेंगलुरु में सिद्धारमैया जी उस समय चीफ मिनिस्टर थे, उन्होंने भी पार्टिसिपेट किया। धर्मशाला में भी हम 2016 में गए, उसमें वीरभद्र सिंह जी जो चीफ मिनिस्टर थे वो भी आए। तिरुवनंतपुरम केरला में मैं विजयन साहब भी आए, बड़ौदा में माननीय मंत्री जी बैठे हैं। हम 19 सितंबर को यानी आज के 3 साल पहले बड़ौदा के अंदर माननीय गडकरी जी की अध्यक्षता में एक मीटिंग करी थी हमने। गुवाहाटी में भी गुवाहाटी के चीफ मिनिस्टर साहब आए थे, सर्वानंद सोनवाल जी। तो इस तरीके से सारे मिनिस्टर्स ने भी हिस्सा लिया, चीफ मिनिस्टर्स ने भी हिस्सा लिया, हमने एनजीओ से भी संपर्क किया जो हमारे ऑफिसर्स थे उनके एक्सपीरियंस का भी लाभ लिया और जगह जगह अलग अलग प्रदेशों में बड़ी बड़ी सिटीज में घूम करके ये देखा कि ये सड़क दुर्घटनाएं जो लगभग 4.5 लाख से 5 लाख तक पूरे देश में प्रतिवर्ष हो जाती है और उसमें 1.5 लाख से ज्यादा मौतें हो जाती है, इनको कैसे रोका जाए और उसको रोकने के उपाय क्या है। तो मैं मेरे एक्सपीरियंस के आधार पर कहूंगा कि जो सेंट्रल मोटर व्हीकल एक्ट 1988 था, आप ये देखिए कि 2019 में जाकर के उसमें अमेंडमेंट हुआ है, तो ये 12 और 19 31 साल बाद, जबकि टेक्नोलॉजी चेंज हो गई, टेक्नोलॉजी में बहुत बड़ा इंप्रूवमेंट हो गया, रोड स्ट्रक्चर बहुत बढ़ गया, मोटर व्हीकल बहुत ज्यादा आ गए, पॉपुलेशन बढ़ गई, लोगों की मतलब आर्थिक स्थिति ठीक होने के कारण उन्होंने 2-व्हीलर और 4-व्हीलर बहुत सारे खरीद लिए और मतलब जो है उनकी स्पीड भी बढ़ गई, व्हीकल्स की पहले स्पीड इतनी नहीं थी, स्पीड भी बढ़ गई, तो इस कारण से दुर्घटनाएं भी बढ़ गई और इस ये देश के लिए चिंता का विषय था। मैं माननीय गडकरी जी का और प्रधानमंत्री नरेंद्र मोदी जी का भी धन्यवाद करूंगा कि उन्होंने इस चिंता को समझा और ग्रुप ऑफ मिनिस्टर्स बनाया और उन लोगों ने काम किया, रही अमेंडमेंट हुआ और पार्लियामेंट ने भी पास किया, सिलेक्ट कमेटी में गया और आपका स्टैंडिंग कमेटी में गया जिसकी आपने चर्चा की और हम सब जगह जा जा करके आपने चर्चा की। तो मेरा ये कहना है कि जब तक हमारे जो अमेंडमेंट में जो पेनल्टीज हमने बढ़ाई, लोग उसको केंद्रित कर रहे हैं, पेनल्टी किस पे लगेगी, जो व्हीकल चलाएगा और वो वायलेशन करेगा, कानून को तोड़ेगा उस पे पेनल्टी लगेगी, जो कानून को मानेगा और संयमित रूप से वाहन को चलाएगा उस पे पेनल्टी नहीं लगेगी। एक तो मेरा ये निवेदन है कि पेनल्टी कोई इश्यू नहीं है, इश्यू ये है कि हमारी जान कैसे बचे, उसके लिए लोगों में जैसे अभी माननीय मंत्री जी नितिन गडकरी जी कर रहे थे कि हम लोगों में अवेयरनेस कैसे लाए, सबसे बड़ी बात यह कि जनता के अंदर इसकी अवेयरनेस लाए। उसमें अगर आप आंकड़े देखेंगे तो 18 साल से 45 साल की उम्र के लोगों की डेथ जो है लगभग 69% हो जाती है, 69% लोग वो हैं जो 18 से 45 वर्ष के, उसमें भी अगर अपन देखें तो 2-व्हीलर से जो डेथ है वो मोर देन 50% है। अगर हम 2-व्हीलर से मरने वालों के लोगों की और लाइट व्हीकल से भी जो एक्सीडेंट्स होते हैं उसमें भी लोगों की मौतें ज्यादा होती हैं, तो ये जो सेगमेंट है इसमें अवेयरनेस, हम जैसे यूथ है उसमें स्कूलों में जाकर के लोगों को जगाएं, हमारे गाँव में जाएं, क्योंकि हमारी मैक्सिमम पॉपुलेशन है वो गाँव में रहती है और 70% से ज्यादा लोग गाँव में रहते हैं, वो मतलब सीधा ही जाकर के स्टेयरिंग पर बैठ करके और ड्राइविंग करने चले जाते हैं, तो इसलिए मतलब स्कूलों में हम जाएं, उनको सड़क दुर्घटनाओं की रोकथाम के उपाय बताएं, उनमें अवेयरनेस जगाएं और हमारा जो पाठ्यक्रम है, करिकुलम है जो है, उसमें भी हम एक मतलब कम से कम हर एक राज्य अपनी भाषा में जो लोकल लैंग्वेज है उसमें पाठ्यक्रम जोड़े सड़क दुर्घटनाओं की रोकथाम के लिए, और उसके साथ साथ में स्कूलों के अंदर हर महीने मतलब अवेयरनेस लाएं, और जैसे हमारा स्पोर्ट्स का एक पीरियड होता था, एक दिन कल्चरल का पीरियड होता था, उसी तरीके से मेरा ये मानना है एक पीरियड स्कूल्स के अंदर जो यंगस्टर्स हैं उनमें रोड सेफ्टी के लिए लाना चाहिए जिससे लोग इसके प्रति जागृत हो, फिर ग्रामीण जनता जो ड्राइवर बन जाते हैं उनमें से उनको बाकायदा ट्रेनिंग देनी चाहिए जिससे ये उनको रोड सेफ्टी के पता हो, सड़क नियमों का पता हो, तो उससे क्या होगा कि वो मतलब जो है दुर्घटना नहीं हो उसके काम कराए, जैसे शराब पी करके कोई चलाता है, ओवर स्पीडिंग है, इन चीजों को हम कैसे रोक सकते हैं, मतलब क्योंकि बच्चे नौजवान बच्चों को उनके माँ बाप लाड़ प्यार में जो है टू व्हीलर दिला देते हैं, बहुत स्पीड से चलाते हैं और लापरवाही के साथ चलाते हैं, ये सब चीजें कैसे रुके, उसके उपाय हमें करने होंगे। मैंने एक अभियान चलाया था, हमारे राजस्थान में 9,896 ग्राम पंचायतें हैं, लगभग 6,000 गांव थे, उन सब गांवों में हमने एक दिन गांधी जी 2 अक्टूबर 2015 को सब जगह पर सारे कलेक्टर्स को निर्देश दिए, सारे एसडीओ को निर्देश दिए और हमने एक पंचायतों के माध्यम से एक अभियान चलाया 7 दिन का। एक दिन में एक साथ सारे पंचायतों को हमने जो है नेटवर्क से जोड़ करके और जागरूक करने का काम किया, इसी तरीके स्कूल्स में जाने का काम किया, इसी तरीके से हमने ऑटोमेटेड ड्राइविंग ट्रैक बनाने का काम किया, इसी तरीके से फिटनेस सेंटर नए खोलने का काम किया। और मैं आपको विशेष रूप से कहूंगा कि मेरी नजर में 3 चीजें हैं, एक तो ह्यूमन एरर मतलब मानवीय गलती की वजह से सड़क दुर्घटनाएं बढ़ती है, दूसरा क्या है कि रोड एनवायरनमेंट भी बहुत जरूरी है, जैसे माननीय मंत्री जी ने ये बात कही रोड इंजीनियरिंग कैसे हो इसकी भी बात कही, एक क्या है कि उसकी व्हीकल की कंडीशन कैसी है, अगर व्हीकल फिट नहीं है, मान लीजिए उसमें ब्रेक ठीक नहीं है मतलब जो है और उसको मतलब पोल्यूशन भी फैला रहा है, मतलब इससे दुर्घटनाएं बढ़ती हैं, तो इन सब पर हम कैसे अपने आप को मतलब जो है हर राज्य काम करें। एक सर ने कहा कि राज्य और केंद्र दोनों के बीच में समन्वय, जब तक समन्वय नहीं होगा राज्य इस बात को समझेंगे नहीं कि भाई ये सड़क दुर्घटनाएं हमारे लिए मतलब जो है रोकना बहुत इम्पोर्टेंट है, तब तक मैं सोचता हूँ कि ये देश आगे नहीं बढ़ सकता। देश को आगे बढ़ाने के लिए हमें सड़क दुर्घटनाओं को रोकने का काम करना होगा, क्योंकि बहुत सारे हमारे अभी आप ये देखिए कि बहुत सारे मिनिस्टर्स भी ऐसे थे जो सड़क दुर्घटनाओं में मर गए, बहुत सारे वीआईपी लोग ऐसे थे जो वैज्ञानिक थे, बहुत सारे ऐसे थे जो हमारे देश का भविष्य थे वो सड़क दुर्घटनाओं में चले गए। तो ये हमारी एक तरीके से देखा जाए देश की जो बहुत अच्छे थाती थी वो हमारे से बीच से चली गई, उसको हम कैसे बचा सके उसके लिए हम सबको मिलकर के काम करना चाहिए, और विशेष रूप से जिला स्तर पर जनप्रतिनिधियों को कैसे जोड़ें, जनता को कैसे जोड़ें, हमारे टीचर्स को कैसे जोड़ें, स्टूडेंट्स को कैसे जोड़ें, महिलाओं को कैसे जोड़ें, ड्राइवर्स को कैसे जोड़ें, ड्राइवर्स की ट्रेनिंग कैसे हो, ये सब चीजों के ऊपर हमें मतलब जो है जन जागृति लानी पड़ेगी। और ये एक दिन का काम नहीं है सर, ये नियमित अभ्यास है, मतलब ये नहीं है कि हमने एक बार एक सप्ताह साल में 365 दिन में 7 दिन रोड सेफ्टी के लिए जन जागृति चला दी, क्योंकि देखिए हर दिन 18 साल के बाद में मेजर होंगे, वो टू व्हीलर खरीदेगा फिर 4 व्हीलर खरीदेगा, तो उसको ट्रेनिंग कैसे दे, इसलिए हमारे ट्रेनिंग स्कूल्स जो है आपने देखा होगा कि ड्राइविंग ट्रेनिंग स्कूल भी होने चाहिए, मोटर ड्राइविंग स्कूल भी होने चाहिए और उसमें ट्रेंड लोग हों, प्रोफेशनल्स हों तो काम चलेगा, अदरवाइज क्या है कि बिना प्रोफेशनल्स पर्सनल्स के हम अगर किसी को ड्राइवर बना देंगे लाइसेंस दे देंगे तो मैं सोचता हूँ ये भी ठीक नहीं, तो ड्राइविंग लाइसेंस किस तरीके से मिले, उसका प्रशिक्षण भी बाकायदा हो राज्य बैठ कर करके। तो जो ये बिल जो अमेंड किया है और अब ये जो 2019 का मतलब बन गया एक्ट बन गया, मैं सोचता हूँ इसको स्टडी करेंगे, तो उसमें 2 चीजें मेरे दृष्टि आपको ध्यान हो, पहले सड़कें सिंगल लेन हुआ करती थी या 2 लेन होना, आजकल 6 लेन 8 लेन रोड्स होगी, रोड्स की स्ट्रेंथनिंग भी बढ़ गई, रोड्स की क्वालिटी भी अच्छी हो गई, और आपने देखा होगा कि जो व्हीकल जो पहले था, पहले वाले व्हीकल में आज के व्हीकल में स्पीड में भी बहुत फर्क है, टेक्नोलॉजी में भी बहुत फर्क है, तो इसके साथ साथ में हमारी टेक्नोलॉजी भी बढ़नी चाहिए, आजकल सारा चीजें मतलब जो है एक्चुअली में आईटी का जमाना आ गया, आईटी के जमाने में किस तरीके से हम जो स्पीड गवर्नर कैसे लगाएं, व्हीकल्स को कैसे ट्रैक करें, व्हीकल्स में कैसे रोड सेफ्टी की चीजें इंक्लूड करें, और लोगों को आजकल ये मोबाइल के माध्यम से आपने देखा होगा कि पहले लोग शराब को भी मानते थे कि दोषी मानते थे और स्पीड को मानते थे, आजकल ये मोबाइल और आ गया, उस मोबाइल की वजह से भी लोगों की दुर्घटनाएं हो रही हैं, उसके साथ साथ में मतलब जो है लोग अभी हेलमेट की चर्चा आई, तो मैं ये कहूंगा कि हेलमेट लगाएं, क्योंकि मैंने एक स्टडी की थी पूरे इंडिया की, उसमें क्या है कि ज्यादातर जो है एक्सीडेंट डेथ होती है 70% लोग जो है हेड इंजरी से जाते हैं, हेड इंजरी से डेथ होती है, उसमें भी 35 साल से नीचे के लोग 80% है उसमें हेड इंजरी वाले में, और उसमें भी मतलब जो है मैक्सिमम लोग टू व्हीलर से, इसको इसको कैसे रोका जा सकता है, तो सारी कंप्रिहेंसिव स्टडी होनी चाहिए, सब राज्यों को इस पे ध्यान केंद्रित करना चाहिए और मतलब 24/7 बाई मतलब 365 दिन इस पर काम होना चाहिए। अदरवाइज तो मतलब अपने एक दिन सप्ताह चला लिया या एक दिन भाषण दे दिया, उसे रोड एक्सीडेंट नहीं रुकने वाले। हमारा देश आज सड़क दुर्घटनाओं में मरने वालों की संख्या में नंबर वन पर है, तो हम इसको धीरे धीरे कैसे काम कर सकते हैं, मैं मेरे अनुभव से कर सकता हूँ, मेरे पास आंकड़े हैं। देखिए राजस्थान में मैंने प्रयास किया तो 2015-16-17 लगातार मतलब डेथ्स भी रिड्यूस हुई, इंजरीज भी रिड्यूस हुई, एक्सीडेंट भी रिड्यूस हुई। और जो ही मैं हमारी गवर्नमेंट चली गई, मैं भी मंत्री नहीं रहा, उसके बाद में मैं एक्सेप्ट नहीं लगा रहा किसी पर, किसी भी गवर्नमेंट पर, क्योंकि वो भी अच्छा काम कर रही है, इस बात नहीं है। लेकिन उनको लगा कि भी पुरानी गवर्नमेंट का या गडकरी जी का ये बिल पास किया हुआ है, बीजेपी गवर्नमेंट का किया हुआ है, हमें लागू नहीं करना चाहिए, उन्होंने लागू नहीं किया, अब उन्होंने जाकर के नोटिफिकेशन खड़ा। लेकिन उसमें मैं आंकड़े देख रहा था कि सडनली मतलब एक्सीडेंट्स भी बढ़ गए और डेथ भी बढ़ गई, तो इसको रिड्यूस करने का हमारा काम, क्योंकि सरकारें बदलती हैं उससे कोई फर्क नहीं पड़ता है, व्यक्ति बदलते हैं उससे कोई फर्क नहीं पड़ता है, लेकिन मतलब कानून का पालन कैसे हो, जन जागृति कैसे आए, लोग सड़क नियमों का पालन कैसे करें, और लोग जो है अपने जीवन को महत्वपूर्ण समझें, साथ साथ में दूसरे के जीवन को महत्वपूर्ण समझें। तो मैं सोचता हूँ कि मेरा टाइम कितना मुझे पता नहीं, चेरियन सर मेरे पास बोलने के लिए बहुत है, माननीय मंत्री जी गुजरात भी मुझे दिख रहे हैं बैठे हैं, और गुजरात ऐसा स्टेट है कि हर तरह की एडवांस है। मुझे उम्मीद है कि अभी प्रधानमंत्री जी भी गुजरात के हैं, माननीय मोदी जी भी इस पर कई बार मन की बात में भी कई बार चर्चा करते हैं, बहुत सारी चर्चा। लेकिन मैं गडकरी जी का धन्यवाद करूंगा कि उन्होंने एक हमारा सेंट्रल रोड फंड है उसमें से 10% हिस्सा राज्यों को सिर्फ रोड सेफ्टी के लिए दिया, और आप देखिए कि पहली बार हमारे राज्य को भी CRF में से 80 करोड़ रुपए एक साल में मिला। तो हमने जो जो हमारी मेडिकल एंड हेल्थ है उसको स्ट्रेंथनिंग किया, एम्बुलेंसेज लगाए, स्पीड गवर्नर्स की ऊपर गए, और रोड सेफ्टी से जुड़े बहुत सारे विषय जिसमें PWD है, मेडिकल एंड हेल्थ है, पंचायत राज है, एजुकेशन डिपार्टमेंट है, इन सब का मिल करके हमने एक ग्रुप बनाया और उससे हमने जन जागृत लाया, क्योंकि ग्राम पंचायतों में सरपंच होता है, पंच होता है, हमारे जनप्रतिनिधि होता है, जिला परिषद के सदस्य, पंचायतों के सदस्य, और हमारे जनप्रतिनिधि MLA MP और सरपंचगण, इन सब के बात जाए, टीचर्स में ये बात जाए, NGOs में ये बात जाए, ये सब चीजें जब भी संभव होगी, जब हम रेगुलर रूप से अथक रूप से प्रयास करेंगे तो हमें इसमें कामयाबी मिलेगी।
Thank you, sir, for your detailed presentation, along with telling about the GOIM process, how it effectively contributed to the Motor Vehicle Act. You also had mentioned the implementation challenges and some of the solution, like the need to focus on the awareness and things like that. And also, you highlighted that and more people are dying on the road than people dying as a result of COVID. So several things you have presented in this time. I will come back to you with more questions. So before that, I will now go to the Honorable Transport Minister of Gujarat, Sri R.C. Faldu. Sir, Gujarat is one of the state, implemented the Motor Vehicle Act, came forward and announced the notified the implementation, though some concerns were there about lowering the penalties of the compounding offenses and all. And as a result of that, you have established the Gujarat Road Safety Authority also. I think it is the second state in the country after Kerala implementing establishing the Road Safety Authority way back in 2007. As a result of that, Honorable Transport Minister Sri Nitin Gadkari ji had presented in the Indian Parliament the reduction in the road accidents in the 5 months of the implementation of the Act. This was on the 19th of March, and Gujarat was on the top among all the states. The national average was 10%, but Gujarat could achieve a reduction of 13.52%. So I want to start with congratulating you, because of this impact, I would like to hear from you, what are the measures that you have taken after passage of this act to reduce the road accidents and the road accident fatalities in the state of Gujarat? Would like to hear from you, sir. Over to you.
नेशनल रोड सेफ्टी वेबिनार का आयोजन करने के लिए आयोजित संस्था को मैं गुजरात की ओर से धन्यवाद प्रदान करता हूँ। आज के इस वेबिनार में भारत सरकार के ट्रांसपोर्ट मिनिस्टर नितिन गडकरी जी ने काफी अच्छा मार्गदर्शन किया है, इसके लिए उनका भी आभार प्रकट करता हूँ और गुजरात की ओर से आप सभी को प्रणाम करता हूँ। मैंने दो दिन पहले मुंह का दांत का ऑपरेशन करवाया है, इसलिए आज ये पैनल डिस्कशन में भाग लेने आ सकता हूं। लेकिन हमारे एमआईएस स्टेट के ईश्वर सिंह पटेल आज के इस पैनल डिस्कशन में गुजरात की ओर से मुझे सिर्फ इतना ही कहना है, हमने 17 फरवरी 2018 में रोड सेफ्टी अथॉरिटी का बिल असेंबली में पारित कर लिया है और तब से लेकर के स्टेट लेवल की कमेटी और सभी जिलाओं में कमेटियों की रचना करके हमने इसके बारे में काफी कदम उठाए। 29 मुद्दों पर जो नालंदा सुप्रीम कोर्ट ने हमें मार्गदर्शन किया, सभी पहलुओं पर लेकर के हम काम कर रहे हैं। 4 स्तंभ हमने जो इंजीनियरिंग वाला स्तंभ है, बाकी 3 स्तंभ है, सभी स्तंभ को लेकर के गुजरात में रोड सेफ्टी अवेयरनेस आए हैं। गुजरात में शाला कॉलेजों में हमारी टीम बैंड के जरिए हम काम जो कर रहे हैं, इसमें हमें काफी बदलाव मिला है, फायदा मिला है, क्योंकि हमारे भारतवर्ष के सभी व्यक्ति हमारे लिए बहुमूल्य है, उनकी कोई कीमत नहीं है, लेकिन वो बहुमूल्य इंसान है और मार्गदर्शन में उनका वृद्धि हो ऐसा हम कभी नहीं सोच पाते, लेकिन आज तक हुआ है। अभी अभी जी ने जो बात बताई कि प्रधानमंत्री जी ने इतने सालों के बाद कि मार्ग अकस्मात में हमारे देश के व्यक्ति जो जा रहे हैं हमारे लिए ठीक नहीं है, कुछ बदलाव अच्छे बदलाव लाना चाहिए। तो हमने गुजरात में जो काम किया है, बहुमूल्य 7 डिपार्टमेंट को जोड़ के हमने जो गुजरात में काम किया है, उसमें हमें 2 साल में जिस प्रकार के अच्छे परिणाम मिले हैं, इसके बारे में हमारे एमएस आपसे बात करेंगे, आदरणीय श्री ईश्वर सिंह पटेल आपसे बात करेंगे। धन्यवाद।
नमस्कार, आदरणीय मंत्री महोदय श्री दीपक गडकरी जी, पदक सुरक्षा वेबिनार में उपस्थित विभिन्न राज्यों के मंत्री महोदय, अधिकारीगण, गुजरात सड़क सुरक्षा प्राधिकरण अधिनियम 2018 के तहत दिसंबर 2018 पत्रिका का गठन किया गया, माननीय सर्वोच्च न्यायालय समिति के आदेश का पूर्णतः अमल गुजरात में किया गया है। इस प्राधिकरण की अध्यक्षता परिवहन मंत्री और कार्यकारी समिति की अध्यक्षता अतिरिक्त मुख्य सचिव परिवहन द्वारा की जाती है। राज्य सड़क सुरक्षा परिषद और गुजरात सड़क सुरक्षा प्राधिकरण की बैठक हर 6 महीने और कार्यकारी समिति की बैठक त्रिमासिक आधार पर आयोजित की जाती है। इस प्राधिकरण में आवास, परिवहन, सड़क, भवन, राष्ट्रीय सड़क निर्माण विभाग, स्वास्थ्य और शिक्षा जैसे 7 डिपार्टमेंट शामिल है। इस सभी डिपार्टमेंट ने सड़क सुरक्षा के लिए अपने क्लास 1 और क्लास 2 ऑफिसर की नियुक्ति भी की है। सड़क सुरक्षा संबंधी गतिविधियों को 4E के रूप में वर्गीकरण किया गया है, जिसमें इंजीनियरिंग, एनफोर्समेंट, एनफोर्समेंट, इमरजेंसी केयर, एजुकेशन एंड अवेयरनेस को शामिल किया गया है। जहां तक गुजरात राज्य की बात है, माननीय सर्वोच्च न्यायालय समिति की रिपोर्ट अनुसार सभी 29 मुद्दों का कार्यान्वयन अंतिम चरणों में है। आज तक 80% है से अधिक काम पूरा हो चुका है। सभी जिला छात्र एवं नागरिकों के शिक्षा हेतु 21 यातायात शिक्षा और जागरूकता मोबाइल वैन आवंटित किए गए हैं। इससे हम 50 लाख से अधिक छात्रों और 70 लाख नागरिकों तक पहुंचने में सफलता मिली है। सड़क सुरक्षा पाठ्यक्रम पाठ्य पुस्तक में शामिल किए गए हैं। स्कूली बच्चों के लिए संकल्प पत्र प्रतिज्ञा पत्र वितरित किए गए हैं। पूरे राज्य में 11 जनवरी 2020 से 17 जनवरी 2020 तक सड़क सुरक्षा सप्ताह आयोजन किया गया था और जन जागृति का प्रचार प्रसार किया गया था। राज्य सरकार और प्राधिकरण के प्रयासों के चलते इस साल मृत्यु घटना में 6.29% यानी कि 447 घटनाएं और गंभीर दुर्घटना में 3.75% यानी कि 227 घटनाएं और सामान्य प्रकार की दुर्घटनाएं में 22.68% यानी कि 1003 घटनाओं की कमी हुई है। गुजरात के लॉकडाउन के समय में स्थानांतरित श्रमिकों की भी चिंता करके उनकी मार्ग सलामती भी सुनिश्चित की है। 20,682 ऐसी बसेस और खानगी बसों को भेजकर 6,47,000 श्रमिकों को अपने वतन भेजा था और 1,006 ट्रेनों से 14,64,000 श्रमिकों को अपने वतन में भेज रही है। ट्रेन और बसों में भेजे गए श्रमिकों मिलाकर समग्र देश में सबसे ज्यादा कुल 21,00,000 श्रमिकों को हमने उनको अपने वतन में पहुंचा दिए है। पूरे राज्य में फ्लैट्स फॉर साइनिंग बोर्ड भी पूरे स्टेट में लगा दिए हैं। गुजरात में बहुत ही अच्छा रोड नेटवर्क है। गुजरात में 99.87% रोड कनेक्टिविटी है। दूसरी तरफ गुजरात में हर महीने में टू व्हीलर और फोर व्हीलर मिला के करीब 1,00,000 नए वाहन रोड पर आते हैं। गुजरात में रोड के विस्तरण चार मल के बनाने का काम अच्छा होता है, जिसकी वजह से ट्रैफिक कम हो और एक्सीडेंट कम हो। नई मोटर कार जो बनती है उसमें बहुत सुविधाएं के साथ गति की भी ज्यादा होती है, जिसके कई लोग तीव्र गति से वाहन चलाते हैं और एक्सीडेंट का कारण बन सकता है। लेकिन गुजरात में कायदा पालन, लोगों को शिक्षित करना और जागरूक करना, ये सभी कार्य में जोर दिया जाता है। लॉकडाउन की भी बात कर रहा हूँ, जून जुलाई के बाद 28.39% एक्सीडेंट कम हुए हैं। जो खतर की बात है वो भी 23.89% कम हुए हैं। इंजरी पर 35.81% कम हुए हैं और 2018 की कंपेरिजन की बात कर रहा हूँ और 2019 में 9.18% एक्सीडेंट कम हुए हैं और फैटल में भी 7.58% कम हुए हैं। भविष्य में अक्टूबर 2020 में आईसेक शिक्षा चैनल के माध्यम से माध्यमिक कक्षा के छात्रों को तालीमबद्ध किया जाएगा और मोबाइल के माध्यम से 15,00,000 से ज्यादा छात्रों को कड़क सुरक्षा जागरूकता संदेश भेजने की योजनाएं है। इस वेबिनार के माध्यम से उपस्थित सभी को गुजरात की ओर से बहुत बहुत शुभकामनाएं प्रदान करता हूँ। वंदे मातरम, भरत मंदिर जय। थैंक यू।
थैंक यू सर। द ऑनरेबल कैबिनेट मिनिस्टर अलोंग विद हिम the Minister of State, Sri Isharbhai Patel ji, also had explained. Thanks for explaining in detail the initiatives taken by Gujarat in addressing the road accidents and the fatalities. We also have one more Transport Minister, the Honorable Transport Minister of Haryana, Sri Moolchand Sharma ji, joining with us. Sir, can you hear me?
Yeah, he's locked out. I can't see his name, in fact.
Yeah, so we will come back later if he is able to log in. Sir, I will come back to Sri Yunus Khanji. Again, specifically on the group of ministers. Do you think that this is an approach you should follow other lawmaking in the countries as well? Or what is the challenge in this approach? What you foresee the challenge in this approach? The reason that I am asking this specific question is I was listening to a press meet or your response to the press in September 2019. You were mentioning many of the states who had agreed to enhance penalty come out and now they are opposing it. Do you think that whether it was because of their local political compulsions or local reasons for that, or whether you see any challenge in this this approach of group of ministers?
Yes, sir. Yes. Sir, इसमें penalties को लेकर के जो issues आए states में और जो सोच बना उसमें मेरा निवेदन ये है कि क्या है कि penalty उसी पर लगेगी जो violation करेगा और जो कानूनन सही चलेगा उस पर तो लगेगी नहीं. और BPL जो है, below poverty line जो लोग हैं इस देश में जिसका हवाला देते हैं पॉलिटिशियंस या राज्य, उनके पास तो विकल्प है ही नहीं. विकल्प तो जो सक्षम है, जो सक्षम है उसके पास है. तो उस सक्षम व्यक्ति के द्वारा अगर कोई गलती की जाती है उस पे पेनल्टी पहुंच होती है. तो इसलिए मेरा ही मानना है कि लोगों का जीवन महत्वपूर्ण है, पेनल्टी महत्वपूर्ण नहीं है. इस दो चीजें अपने समझनी पड़ेगी. इससे कोई वोट बैंक में फर्क नहीं पड़ता है, इस पे फर्क पड़ता है तो आदमी के जीवन पर फर्क पड़ता है. इसलिए जीवन सर्वोच्च है. और अगर मान लीजिए एक तो उसमें एक्सीडेंट के बाद में हो जाती है डेथ, दूसरा होता है कि एक्सीडेंट के बाद इंजरी के बाद में वो परमानेंटली मतलब डिसेबल हो जाता है. तो कई बार तो क्या है कि अनकॉन्शियस हो जाता है, तीन तीन साल तक बेड में रहता है. तो ऐसी स्थिति में वो व्यक्ति महत्वपूर्ण है जो दुर्घटना में घायल हो गया और बेहोश हो गया, होश में नहीं आ रहा है या परमानेंटली डिसेबल हो गया. तो उनके जीवन को ध्यान में रखते हुए पेनल्टी कोई मायने नहीं रखती है. इसलिए मेरे सब राज्यों से यह है कि हमने सब लोगों से विचार विमर्श किया है, सारे राज्यों की कंसेंसस ली है, सिलेक्ट कमेटी में भी गए हैं, स्टैंडिंग कमेटी में भी गए हैं, सब राज्यों के मिनिस्टर से मिले हैं, सब ये जो हमारे ट्रांसपोर्ट के इंस्पेक्टर से उनसे मिले हैं, बस ऑपरेटर से मिले हैं, ट्रक ऑपरेटर से भी मिले हैं, एनजीओ से भी मिले हैं, पब्लिक से भी राय लिए, स्कूल्स में भी राय लिए. तो ये सब चीजों के राय मशवरे के बाद में ये क्या पेनल्टी इतनी इम्पोर्टेंट नहीं है, इसलिए उस पर नहीं जाए. हम जन जागृति कैसे लाए उस पर फोकस करें, क्योंकि जब तक पब्लिक अवेयरनेस नहीं होगी तब तक कुछ नहीं होगा. क्योंकि इसमें देखा जाए तो स्टेक होल्डर कौन है? आम आदमी. जो जनरल जो पब्लिक है वो है, क्योंकि कोई कुछ तो सड़क पे चलते हैं, कुछ पैदल चलते हैं, कुछ साइकिल से चलते हैं, कुछ टू व्हीलर से चलते हैं, कुछ फोर व्हीलर से चलते हैं, कुछ जो है गुड्स व्हीकल है वो जो है रोड के ऊपर आते हैं. कई बार देखते हैं, मैं राजस्थान में, मेरा अनुभव है 2007 का, 2007 के अंदर एक राजस्थान में दुर्घटना हुई, आप आश्चर्य करेंगे, एक गुड्स व्हीकल पे जो ट्रक होता है ना, ट्रक उस पे उसने दो पार्ट बना लिए, मतलब और पार्ट बना करके 80 यात्री बिठा के ले गया. एक हमारा रामदेवरा का मेला लगता है यहाँ, लोकल मंदिर है, उसमें मेले के अंदर गांव वालों को कह दिया खाना मेरी तरफ से आप चलो. वो एक्सीडेंट हुआ और उसमें 79 पीपल एक साथ ही मर गए एक व्हीकल से. तो ये इस तरीके से 79 लोग मर जाना, 79 पीपल मर जाना बहुत बड़ी दुर्घटना. अभी रोज अखबार पढ़ते हैं 6 लोग मर गए, 5 मर गए, गाड़ी उसके अंदर घुस गई, नींद आ गई, मतलब ड्राइवर की लापरवाही थी, एक ड्राइवर रखते हैं. तो ये सब चीजों के पर हम ध्यान करें. ड्राइविंग ट्रेनिंग सेंटर खोलें, मोटर ड्राइविंग स्कूल खोलें. पोल्यूशन के लिए हमने पूरे पेट्रोल पंप्स को अधिकृत किया था. इसी तरीके से मान लीजिए ज्यादा से ज्यादा लोगों को किस तरीके से एजुकेट करें, मतलब एजुकेशन पर ज्यादा ध्यान देना होगा. जब एजुकेशन पर ध्यान देंगे हम और ये हाईवेज के ऊपर मतलब ड्राइवर्स के रेस्ट मतलब के लिए जगह बनाए प्रॉपरली, जो हमारे रेस्टोरेंट्स हैं रोड पर रोड साइड में पेट्रोल पंप है उन पर मतलब स्लोगन्स लिखे, उन पर हम जो है ये सब चीजें लगाएं, होर्डिंग्स लगाएं, बैनर लगाएं, बुक्स दें उनको, मतलब जो है जैसे मान लीजिए गुजरात के लोग बैठे हैं, माननीय मंत्री जी बैठे हैं गुजरात के, तो गुजराती भाषा में दें, कोई है मान लीजिए तमिल का तो तमिल भाषा में दें, तो अलग अलग लैंग्वेज में हम बुक्स साफ करके अवेयरनेस के ड्राइवरों को किस तरीके से गाड़ी चलाना चाहिए, कितनी नींद लेनी चाहिए, गाड़ी चलाते हुए शराब नहीं पीनी चाहिए, ओवर लोड व्हीकल को नहीं चलाना चाहिए, और स्पीड नहीं होनी चाहिए, और मतलब बाएं दाएं का ध्यान रखें, जो साइन बोर्ड लगे हुए उनका ध्यान रखें, जो लाल बत्ती है तो उस पर गाड़ी रोके, बहुत सारी बार हम देखते हैं लाल बत्ती में लोग अपना क्रॉस कर जाते हैं, लोग मर जाते हैं। तो ये जो जो हमने अमेंडमेंट करवाया बिल में, ये तो क्या है कि बहुत पुराना बिल था, उसमें अभी टेक्नोलॉजी भी नहीं आ गई, रोड की कंडीशन भी अच्छी हो गई, व्हीकल का भी मतलब जो है नई टेक्नोलॉजी आ गई, तो इन सब चीजों को ध्यान में रखते हुए आईटी बहुत ज्यादा डेवलप हो गया, उनको ध्यान में रखते हुए इन सब चीजों का हमने समावेश किया, और मुझे खुशी है कि मैक्सिमम राज्य धीरे धीरे इसको मान रहे हैं, और हमारी 21 राज्यों के तो मिनिस्टर्स ने पार्टिसिपेट किया साथ, टोटल 29 राज्यों के ऑफिसर्स मिनिस्टर्स ने किया, और जो फील्ड में हमारे ट्रांसपोर्ट के जो इंस्पेक्टर्स रहते हैं वो भी बाद में उनके एसोसिएशन भी तैयार हो गई, और बहुत सारी एसोसिएशन जैसे हमारा डीलर है, हमारा जो डीलर है उनके यहाँ भी अब आजकल हमने नए कानून में कह दिया कि रोड सेफ्टी का एक काउंटर अलग से लगाए, डीलर्स के भी ये कह दिया, जो ड्राइविंग लाइसेंस बनाने आता है तो उसके साथ एक बुकलेट रोड सेफ्टी की दी जाती है, स्कूलों के अंदर भी आप इनको रखिए रोड सेफ्टी को, तो ये हमारे लिए सब जगह, और पंचायत मुख्यालयों पर रखी, मैंने माननीय नरेंद्र तोमर साहब थे पंचायत राज मंत्री और रूरल डेवलपमेंट मिनिस्टर, उनसे मुलाकात करके उनको भी निवेदन किया, राजस्थान में पंचायत राज को, पीडब्ल्यूडी को, स्कूल को, सबको हमने मेडिकल हेल्थ का और बाकायदा डेडिकेटेड मतलब जो है एक प्रकोष्ठ मतलब खोला हमने और उसके माध्यम से काम किया, क्योंकि और हाईवे के ऊपर जो हमारी पीएससी है, सीएससी है, ट्रोमा सेंटर है, उनको स्ट्रेंथनिंग करने का काम हमें करना चाहिए। तो मेरा ये कहना है कि भाई ज्यादा से ज्यादा हम अगर रोड सेफ्टी पर फोकस करेंगे, एनजीओस को भी स्ट्रेंथनिंग करना, जो सीआरएफ का पैसा आया अभी ब्लैक स्पॉट के लिए तो पैसा ऑलरेडी उसमें आप कर दीजिए, रोड मैं पीडब्ल्यूडी का भी 5 साल मिनिस्टर रहा हूं, तो जब आप रोड बनाने के लिए जब टेंडर करें तो उसमें रोड सेफ्टी का प्रोविजन भी आप करें, और मैंने ये इंक्लूड किया पहली बार कि रोड सेफ्टी का अलग से उस कॉन्ट्रेक्टर को, हमारा जो एग्जीक्यूटिव इंजीनियर है उनको कैसे हम पाबंद करें, ये चीजें भी हमें ध्यान में रखने का काम किया।
थैंक यू सर फॉर अगेन इलैबोरेटिंग एंड आल्सो अंडरलाइनिंग द नीड।
एक चीज मैं आपको और कहूंगा, ये देखिए ये जो है ना पॉकेट, ये जो है इस तरीके के हमने बुकलेट छाप करके हर ड्राइवर को हाईवेज पे दिया, इसमें सड़क सुरक्षा के नियमों का कैसे हम करें, इस तरीके की छोटी छोटी पॉकेट बुक्स अलग अलग लैंग्वेज में हम छाप करके देंगे ड्राइवर्स को, और मैंने सारे जितने टोल हैं उन टोल नाकों पे कंपलसरी कर दिया था, पेट्रोल पंप पर कंपलसरी कर दिया था कि ये बुकलेट आप देंगे, उससे बहुत फर्क पड़ा।
थैंक यू सर फॉर अंडरलाइनिंग द नीड फॉर awareness and also elaborating many of the initiatives you have made. Now I will go back to Gujarat again to the Honorable Minister and the State Minister. So we started with a positive note, you know, Gujarat was able to reduce the road accidents and the fatalities. But recently, last week, the National Crime Report Bureau had released the report for 2019. In that, they have raised certain concerns about all state and national level, but with regard to Gujarat, it is mentioned 77% of the accident is happening due to overspeeding. 13% of the accident is happening as a result of dangerous driving. And the child safety is also underlined as a concern there. And the media also had mentioned when the city like Ahmedabad, you know, the traffic police mainly think the traffic should move on instead of the focus of having saving lives on the road. So Can you tell us, what are your plans to addressing this overspeeding, dangerous driving, things like that? Whether already any measures are taken, or what are your plans with regard to that? Over to you, sir.
गुजरात में एनफोर्समेंट डिपार्टमेंट वो कामगिरी करते हैं और उनकी वजह से ओवर स्पीड जो चलाते हैं उनको भी एक्शन ले जाते हैं और सभी को उनकी संख्या भी दे रहे हैं गुजरात के अंदर, और वो एनफोर्समेंट डिपार्टमेंट पूरी तरह से सभी को समझा के अच्छी ढंग से गाड़ी चला तो सभी कामगिरी यहाँ गुजरात में करते हैं और उनका लाइसेंस भी सस्पेंड कर सकते हैं जो करा रहे हैं। और लेकिन अभी यूनिवर्सिटी ने बात की पेनल्टी लेने से कोई फायदा नहीं है, क्योंकि जो लोग मर जाते हैं ये कैसे बचे, उसी तरह हमारे गुजरात की ओर से भी ये कामगिरी
Thank you, sir, for explaining the measures taken by the Gujarat government in addressing this concern. And we look forward to Gujarat continuing in the reduction of these fatalities. I think due to the time constraint, we will conclude the session here. On my behalf, thanks to Sri Yunus Khan Ji and also the Honorable Minister and State Minister from Gujarat. Now I hand over to my colleague Ashim Sanyal for summing up and of the team.
Thank you, George. I think this is one of those very explanatory sessions that having a person like Yunus Khan and not gaining any knowledge, ye to ho hi nahi sakta hai. Yunus Khan sahab aaye hamare beech mein aur hame kuch samjha ke na jaye, to ye to possible hi nahi tha. To main bahut dhyan se sun raha tha, bahut baatein उन्होंने बताई है जो एक्चुअली लागू करने वाली है, और हम लोग जो है जो एनजीओ सेक्टर वाले हैं, आई थिंक वी हैव अ बिग बिग रोल टू प्ले इज समथिंग, बिकॉज इट इज समथिंग विच इज अ मल्टी स्टेक होल्डर थिंग, इट इज नॉट अबाउट एन एक्ट और अ लॉ और जस्ट इन एनफोर्समेंट, तो इट्स अ मल्टी सेक्टोरल अप्रोच दैट वी हैव टू टेक. I must also thank Faldo sir for being here along with Minister of State. So it is Gujarat always leads the way, as we understand, for the last several years, and Gujarat has taken some steps. It's very, very important for us to understand that. In conclusion, I must say that as a summary, first of all, on behalf of Consumer Voice and Road Safety Network, the Honorable Minister for spending extra time with us despite not being well. He was not keeping well, and despite having overlapping meetings because of which he had to rush and leave us, in fact, at a time where actually he wanted to spend more time. But our gratitude to the Honorable Minister for his summing up of various situations that he posed to him. And I think we got a summary of what he spoke. We are indeed thankful to all our honorable MPs who could make it to this session. Some of them had to leave because of other commitments and other meetings. And of course, we are very thankful to all the state transport ministers who are again there in the initial stages, in fact, but had to leave one by one because of their own commitments. We can't really hold them back because of our own interest, but then I think it was a very, very useful session overall for all of us. The takeaways obviously will be many from this particular two-hour session. In fact, simply I must say that the directives given by the minister himself, in fact, in terms of his suggestions to various groups, is of prime importance to us. The points made by Mr. Jay Panda and Mr. KTS Tulsi as members of parliament are of prime importance to us in terms of implementation. The points made by Kelly and Julie, basically from the international best practices side, in terms of their ability to actually steer the road for the MVA implementation in India is of vital importance to us. And last but not the least, I must thank my panelists, in fact, whether they have spoken or not, along with the and of course the presenter for having being on dot in terms of the timing and specific to the points that we wanted to actually elaborate from the side of Road Safety Network. So thank you all of you for giving us opportunity to host this event, and I think we all have something to take back home and deliberate how to move forward in terms of MVA and its implementation and enforcement. Thank you all on behalf of Consumer Voice and Road Safety Network. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.